Senator O'Bannon.
Thank you, Mr. President. I rise gratefully in support of this resolution to this great man we honor today. When I was thinking about possibly making comments this weekend, I thought quite quickly about the Old Testament office of prophet. Prophet was a theme in the Old and New Testament, the Hebrew and Christian scriptures. Few sought the responsibilities of being a prophet. Typically, God pressed a little-known pious man or woman into service, recruited them to give a message that was not very popular, but they did so out of conviction and a sense of responsibility. The prophet was given something unpopular to say to the authorities and people of his or her day who had strayed from God's will. Jeremiah was thrown into a well, if you remember that from Sunday school. Amos was tortured and slain. All prophets were ridiculed in one manner or another. The writer of Hebrews summarizes the fate of the prophets. They were put to death by stoning. They were sawed in two. They were killed by the sword. They went about in sheepskins, goatskins, destitute, persecuted, and mistreated. The world was not worthy of them. A prophet's source of authority is moral. He or she isn't typically part of some power structure. He often has served alone or with a few people who had the ears to hear and the eyes to see that he was given some special message from God. And that message had a variation to it. It was usually something about how the arrogant legal structure or officials had strayed from God's will and had forgotten to protect the powerless and the oppressed. Reverend Martin Luther King Jr. was an American prophet. Perhaps he's been our only real prophet. Even though he himself never took that title, I think his moral sense and oratory skills were honed within the Christian church. Like all true prophets, he drew his power and courage from the righteousness of his message. And like all prophets, he suffered for it. He was spat upon, he was beaten, he was jailed in Birmingham, he was spied on by the FBI, and one day he was martyred. A word about the political and social structure that Martin Luther King Jr. confronted. You can draw a straight line from slavery to Jim Crow segregation and the social injustice of the 1960s. Jim Crow was nothing less than the form of slavery that our nation allowed the South to get away with following the defeat in the Civil War. Here are a few words of our American prophet to the religious establishment in 1963 from the Birmingham jail. Wherever the early Christians entered a town, the power structure got disturbed and immediately sought to convict them for being disturbers of the peace and outside agitators. But they went on with the conviction that they were a colony of heaven and had to obey God rather than man. They were small in number, but big in commitment. They were too God-intoxicated to be intimidated. They brought an end to such ancient evils as infanticide and gladiatorial contest. We will have to repent in this generation not merely for the hateful words and actions of the bad people, but for the appalling silence of the good people. Injustice anywhere is a threat to injustice everywhere. We are caught in an inescapable network of mutuality, tied in a single garment of destiny. Whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly, he said. These were tough, uncompromising words of an American prophet, emboldened by the moral message that he was given. And like all true prophets, he endeavored to obey God rather than man. Every age needs our MLKs, those with real moral courage, those who are God-intoxicated and willing to suffer, to strive against injustice. For such men and women, and they're rare indeed, the world is not worthy.